morning. I'm Grace Ngo here at SBTN-DC with the Youth in Media program. We will start off our program with an explanation of the debt ceiling. Afterwards, we will be interviewing Jackie Baumwright, who will be discussing with us the necessity of raising the debt ceiling and the potential consequences if a compromise is not achieved by Congress by August 2nd. Then, stick around as we will be talking about the tragedy that happened in Norway. To end our show, we will be covering the World Scouting Jamboree, which is currently being held in Sweden. As of late, there has been lots of talk about the debt ceiling in the news and other media. Many of you have most likely been wondering, what is the debt ceiling and how does it affect my life? Today, we will explore the current debt ceiling and its origins. Afterwards, we will explain the effects and significance of the debt ceiling. And to wrap it up, we will talk about the intense and ongoing debate that is going on between the Republicans and Democrats these past few months. The debt ceiling is like the credit card limit on your credit card. Once you have hit the credit limit, the credit card company or bank simply does not allow you to make any more charges on your credit card. In our government's case, the debt ceiling is a self-imposed credit limit set by Congress. In the early 1900s, when the U.S. Treasury wanted to spend money, they would use whatever cash they had on hand. But when the Treasury ran out of cash, they would borrow taxpayers' money by selling U.S. Treasury bonds. They continued to borrow money, and as time went on, it became standard way of doing government business. Everything was fine until after World War I, when Congress needed to come up with a huge amount of money in order to pay off their debts that were accumulated due to war expenses. Unsure of what to do, Congress asked the United States Treasury Department for assistance. In 1917, Congress passed the Liberty Bond Act, which set a limit on government spending. This limit is what we call the debt ceiling. Every time the United States Treasury needed more money, they had to have the permission of Congress. This process of asking for money became known as raising the debt ceiling. The first debt ceiling was set in 1917, which was set at $11.5 billion. Over the years, presidents have passed many bills and signed off on many programs that have increased and raised the debt ceiling even more. What has happened since May, since that time in 1917? The debt ceiling has been raised 102 times, 10 times in our decade alone. The current debt ceiling, the most that we can legally borrow at the moment, is $14.3 trillion. That limit was hit on May 16th, and since then, the United States Treasury has not been able to sell bonds to borrow more money for expenses. Timothy Geithner, the Secretary of Treasury, has had to pull cash from whatever funds the U.S. Treasury had on hand to pay bills. The estimate is that by August 2nd, the U.S. Treasury will run out of cash. If Congress does not vote to raise the debt ceiling once again, the U.S. government will run out of cash to pay its bills and will have to default on the bills and bonds that are due on August 2nd and onward. If the U.S. government defaulted on its obligations, then what experts say will most likely happen is that it will destabilize the entire global financial system. Interest rates would skyrocket. The price of gas, electronics, food, and clothing would increase. Everything would go up. The government would run out of money to pay for federal workers, our soldiers, food stamps, tax refunds, even Social Security, and Medicare payments could all be in jeopardy if Congress does not take action. If Congress fails to come to an agreement, the government will shut down some of its non-essential services, such as passport processing, the Federal Housing Administration, Small Business Administration, the National Park Service, and museums and monuments in the D.C. area. As of right now, the Democrats and Republicans are on opposite sides of the fence. But currently, the Democrats are in the minority in the House of Representatives. They have the weaker position, yet they dominate the Senate. Currently, the most prominent Democrat proposal is the Reid Plan, as proposed by Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid. His plan attempts to strike a compromise between cutting expenses and raising taxes on the wealthiest Americans, specifically those making more than $250,000 a year. Thus, the Reid Plan will cut expenses and reduce entitlements, such as Social Security and Medicare, while also raising taxes on the wealthy. The poor and middle class higher taxes. On the other side of the aisle, the Republicans' proposal is known as the Boehner Plan, proposed by House Majority Leader John Boehner. This plan aims to lower expenses, but not raise taxes at all. Boehner follows a model of cut, cap, and balance. Cut means that if Congress cuts the debt ceiling, then Congress must also cut spending by the same amount that was raised, or more. Cap stands for cap any future expenditure, while balance stands for balancing the budget. While the Republicans and Democrats debate and argue over the debt ceiling, President Obama is acting as the middleman. The past few weeks saw President Obama holding several intense meetings at the White House with top members of Congress in an attempt to come to a compromise. However, such compromise has yet to come to fruition. As of this past Monday, President Obama put his support behind the Reid plan, and he is calling out to Congress to come to a compromise immediately or else face default on August 2nd. On Friday, July 22nd, 76 people died in two connected attacks on Norway. At 3:26 p.m., a car bomb was detonated in Oslo, the Norwegian capital, creating a massive blast that blew out the windows of the Prime Minister's office and damaged the finance and oil ministries. 8 people were killed in this initial attack, and 100 more were believed to be injured. The Prime Minister himself, Jens Stoltenberg, was not in the office at the time and was confirmed to be safe. Later on, according to Norwegian news agency, NTB, and Norwegian Broadcasting Corporation, NRK, reports at around 4:57 p.m., a man dressed as a police officer armed with a pistol and automatic rifle was transported to Utoa Island, 20 miles northwest of Oslo, where the Norway Labour Party was holding its annual youth camp, where many of the attendees were aged 14 to 18. The man began randomly shooting and killing scores of young people at the island camp. According to eyewitness accounts, the man, Anders Bering Breivik, dressed as a police officer, offered to help some campers, only to open fire on the unsuspecting youth. Some victims were shot as they attempted to swim away from the island. The total death toll from the shootings on Utoa Island alone was 68. Finally, at around 6:27 p.m., the first police squad to arrive spotted the gunman, and he surrendered with no resistance. Hospital sources later said that he used what are called dum-dum belt bullets, which are designed to cause maximum internal damage. Anders Bering Breivik later confessed to both attacks. A right-wing Christian extremist, Breivik published an entire 1,500-page manifesto in English, titled 2083, in a video, Marxist Hunter, online only hours before the attacks. In his manifesto and video, he detailed what he described as the Islamification of Western Europe and compared himself to the Knights Templar and the Crusaders. The process in which he prepared for the July 22nd attacks was also detailed in his publications. Breivik discussed the different phases and difficulty of his plan. Anders Bering Breivik's goal from this attack was to spark an anti-multiculturalism revolution. Breivik is now facing terrorism charges and could also be charged with crimes against humanity. Breivik's lawyer, Geir Lippestad, stated that the whole case has indicated that he is insane.
This whole case is indicated that he's insane.
However, he has not yet confirmed that his client, Mr. Breivik, would plead insanity in court. This past Monday, tens of thousands of people gathered in Oslo for a Rose March to mourn the victims and demonstrate defiance and protest against the bloodshed that occurred on Friday, July 22nd.
Good morning. My name is Tong Pham, and I'm part of Boy Scout of America here in Northern Virginia under a Vietnamese troop. Today, I am going to talk to you about the World Scout Jamboree happening right now in Sweden. The World Scout Jamboree is a scout sponsored event that happens every 4 years, and it lasts anywhere from 11 to 12 days. This year, it is held in Sweden. The amount of estimated scout that will be there is around 38,000. From 150 different countries. There are sub-camps, and for every sub-camps, there are 2,000 patrols. Each consists of 36 different scouts, which are randomly selected. They could range from a scout coming from the US, or a scout from Hong Kong, Europe, anywhere such as German, England. For the towns, there's also an extra one which are organized for adults, which is called Spring. The activities that are held here at the World Scout Jamboree consist of whitewater rafting, mountain biking, mountain climbing, and other activities. There are also events and activities where scouts have to work with each other in orienteering, cooking. I personally happen to know a scout here. Her name is Bambi, and she is part of the Potomac Girl Scout. She departed Virginia 3 days ago, and she has sent us an email yesterday about how her first day went. She showed us pictures of her new friends and how they traded patches and the friendship knot.